All right. Welcome to the Christmas special, which won't be that special because we have to go fast. We can't spend a lot of time on making it all pretty. Now, today's a gorgeous day. I spent my day working in the yard. I'm so tired. My back is hurting. And I was from just all the... And I'll show you if this will go. Okay, there's just a bit of some of the cleanup I did. A bin full of trash. Here's another bin full of other types of trash. And here's a bin full of planting containers that I planted. And I did a lot of planting in between storms. Having a nice day, I was able to put a lot of flowers in various pots. Planted about 48 flowers actually. And some other various plants. So super busy day, cleaning up everything, using the blower, blowing off everything, getting everything really neat, clean, tidy, and wouldn't you know it, Christmas time, what do we have? We have two oranges on this little tree. Isn't that great? Two wonderful oranges. Maybe very symbolic. And also, I took out the tomatoes, and wouldn't you know, actually, we still have some tomato plants, and look what we got today. The smaller ones that were off the plants that I pulled out, and the bigger ones, the plants are still going, and got two beautiful tomatoes today. Isn't that amazing? All right, and yesterday was incredibly, incredibly stormy. The video up here, if it's going to work. It might be choppy. The street was just a river, just an absolute river. As you can see right here, the whole street was a river. It's unbelievable. And then the creek. Let me see what we got here. That's not quite, there you go. That's a little choppy right now broadcasting, but you can get the gist of it. It's just absolutely incredibly high. All right. That's it for the special effects. The additional Christmas, that's the Christmas special as far as... So today, this is Christmas Eve, and I've got all the stuff taken care of. The yard is very immaculate, I would say. Everything looks very beautiful, settled, getting ready for another storm tomorrow. And you see, we have to keep working, have to keep working, have to keep working. One thing that I don't like about Christmas is people tend to use it as an excuse to waste time. Don't want to waste time. We want to continue pressing our advantage, because if we don't press our advantage in this world, we default to the overwhelming current of existence, which is the belief in that this is necessary, or it's very important that we continue on trying to discover a way to survive annihilation. We're trying different ways. One of them is to tell a perfect lie and say that we never were part of reality. We never were children of reality in the first place, so the annihilation of reality doesn't affect us at all. That's just something we just try to make up and believe in it so strongly that we think that's going to be the answer. Or the other ways we try to find some way where we somehow believe that the annihilation is real, but in the belief that it's real, somehow we transcend it. Oh, crazy, crazy, crazy notions. And we continue to simply be indeterminate and say, well, we just don't know what's this. Let's just eat. Let's eat and drink and laugh and talk to people and just live our lives as best we can. Have fun here and hopefully everything will be fine. But we cannot, those who want to see truly, cannot afford to squander their days in that sort of activity. We have to continue to press our advantage all the time, all the time, all the time. And at the same time, I have to do all this work of cleaning up, constantly cleaning up, tidying up, planting, just trying to keep up appearances, as it were, in this world, appearing to go along with the currents of the world, which is to try to beautify this world, believing that this is our home, and that we're not children of reality, we're children of existence. This is our home. The way to be happy is to beautify this place, etc. Now, it's important to note that the reassurers are coming to this world. The real teachers are simply reassurers that reassure us that we're not here. We never left reality. We're not here in existence at all. We have an appearance that we're a symbolic appearance that we're identifying with, but we're not here at all. No one's ever left reality. And that there's an actual another hypothetical scenario we can exchange this one for. Right now we have the hypothetical scenario of trying to develop a contingency plan for the annihilation of reality, trying to survive that annihilation. So it's a contingency plan of surviving annihilation. There's also another contingency plan, which is the hypothetical, not a contingency plan, it's another hypothetical, which says the hypothetical of non-annihilation. So there's no survival games. There's no need to try and survive. Everything we see is not being threatened at all. There's no annihilation present, and yet there is an environment, as it were, a perception of a place present, just like it's like a blessed world. The world is completely blessed, where there's nothing threatened, nothing being harmed in any way, no need to try and survive, figure out ways to survive or anything like that. There is that, and so we can choose that, exchange one hypothetical for another. So the reassurers come into this world simply to reassure us that they're not even here, and that we're not here either. And there's just appearances, and there's an intermediate step back to reality. That's all they're here for. They're not here to prevent wars. They're not here to bring world peace. They're not here to try and thwart anybody or any situation. Very important to note that from the standpoint of truth, everyone is free to engage with any idea they want. And if they want to engage with this hypothetical scenario, which comes from really the idea of wanting to be prime creator, desiring to be prime creator, that's what it arises from. If they want to do that, they're free to do that. And if they want to continue to play these survival games, to continue to engage with this completely unnecessary contingency plan, they're free to do so. Nobody's trying to stop them from doing so. If they want to engage in wars, they're free to do so. If they want to destroy the planet, they're free to do so. If they want to, all this is survival games, challenges to their survival, and they want to continually test themselves to see if they can survive and how well they can survive and to learn from all these extreme situations, they're free to do so. I'm not trying to stop anyone from doing that at all. So I don't hate anybody. If someone wants to do that, they're free to do it. But freedom goes both ways. We're also free to exchange hypothetical scenarios, you see. Freedom goes both ways. So yes, everyone is free to continue their survival games, and everyone is also free to exchange hypothetical scenarios for a non-annihilation situation where there's no threat to survival whatsoever. And yet everything, all forms are still present. It's just there's no threat to them whatsoever. They're not threatened with having to try and survive in any way, and yet there's a familiarity to what you see. So we're all free to choose that at any point too. Again, freedom goes both ways. Both ways. Very important. Maybe that's what the two oranges were there for on the tree. Either one hypothetical or the other. We're free to choose whichever one we want. At every moment, we're always free to choose whatever we want. But then again, we're not here to oppose anyone. Truth is not opposing anything. What is there to oppose for truth? Nothing. Truth is free. Freedom, absolute freedom is free. And if absolute freedom wants to believe that it can annihilate itself and work on a contingency plan for that, they're free to do that. It's free. Every aspect of spirit is free to engage with whatever the idea they want to engage with. So, again, not here. The last thing I would do would be to pray for world peace. That's not what I'm here for at all. Or anyone who is keen on truth, gravitating towards realization of truth, they're not trying to thwart the survival games. I mean, what would happen if you tried to take away the survival games of those who felt it was all important? They would be completely freaked out and driven even deeper into terror and fear. the idea that God is going to come into the world and set everything straight and institute world peace and everything is nonsense. God is not engaged in existence like that. God just simply looked and said, "This is all entirely unnecessary," and that's it. That's the only judgment God made. It's unnecessary. Just said, informed spirit, there's no necessity to this contingency plan, and that's it. If we want to play with this idea, fine. But imagine if we suddenly enforced world peace somehow, and enforced that there nothing here was threatened and everything. That those what would those who are here, which is the vast majority of this world, what would they do? Those who are desperately seeking challenges to their survival, thinking that this is the only way they can grow, evolve their consciousness, evolve their soul to the point where it can survive annihilation. What would they do? For them, it would be absolute hell. They would absolutely hate it. They'd hate whoever did that, and they would fight against it. That is a fact. That is a fact. So we're not here to take away the survival games of anyone. I've been here for 56 years. I've not been trying to stop these survival games. I've not been interfering with whatever anybody wants to do. Not interfering at all. If people want to challenge themselves, their survival, they're free to do so. I'm not judging them in any way. I'm just saying you're free to do so, and I'm free to not engage in such games also. So again, freedom goes both ways. Everyone's perfectly free, including myself, including you. If you don't want to engage that, you don't have to. And it's not interfering with their game. They can continue their survival games. And if they want to take it that you're choosing not to engage in the survival game is another challenge for them, they're free to do that. And they will look at it that way. They'll look at, this is like a really, really dangerous challenge. Even though it's not at all, they will see it that way. And they're free to do so because that is their perspective. They want to find a way. They want a contingency plan in case reality is annihilated. The fact is, it will never be annihilated, so it's totally unnecessary. There you go. Very, very simple, but it's super important to realize we're not in opposition. Truth is not in opposition to anything. Not coming here to try impose world peace or impose health on anybody. Again, a lot of people, their illnesses are their most important thing that they have. Super important. Because it provides this intense, intense challenge. Now, I had a super intense challenge of severe depression and severe bad health, etc. But the way that I'm getting out of it is to realize that I don't want those survival challenges at all. I'm not curing it in some way. I mean, that option is always available in existence, but I'm saying, no, I want to exchange the hypothetical contingency plan, the unnecessary hypothetical contingency plan of surviving annihilation for the contingency plan, for the other hypothetical of non-annihilation, no need to survive anything because there's no annihilation. So that as gravitating towards that, you begin to let go of the challenges to your survival. And I still have some ways to go. I'm facing my own fiscal cliff coming up this week, actually. Probably even coinciding with January 1st, actually, if I'll reach my own fiscal cliff. So that would be a severe challenge to my survival. And hopefully there's my clarity is such that I can decide, you know what, I don't need that challenge to my survival. So I don't know. We've all taken on a lot of challenges here in this world. We come in to take on these challenges. I unfortunately didn't want to take on these challenges, but fell into them, trying to share the truth with this world, which the world wouldn't accept it. So I said, "Well, I've got to find something that they'll accept," and then that caused the problems. That caused the fall. It's possible nobody will accept this teaching, but there's only one way. There's only one way, which is truth, which is the non-necessity of this entire hypothetical contingency plan. There isn't any other way. Eventually, you have to accept this is all not necessary. No, we're not even here. There's nothing taking place. There's nothing ever taking place. It's all been just an imaginary dream of the future, which will never take place. That has to happen. So the teaching has to be that. It has to be that. It has to be there with that. There is no other teaching to give that's legitimate. So even if nobody understands it, it's not a fault of the explainer. It is not. I have to accept that. It wasn't my fault. It's that that people want to continue on their survival games. They want to have that contingency plan in their back pocket just in case. So they're not going to listen to it. They're not going to hear it. If that's what, you know, they want to hear it, there's nothing I can do, nothing anybody can do. Nobody can force someone else to accept truth. Because they say, well, yes, truth is true, but in the future it won't be. It might not be. See, it's a hypothetical. So you can't force that on anyone. Anyone can say, yeah, what you're saying is true, but I want to be sure that I have this contingency plan in case there's a problem. And I say, well, there never will be. And they say, well, you can't know that. And that's where we part ways, because you can't know that. Reality knows that it's eternal and will never have any problems. And what is there? What else is there to change it? Nothing. Nothing at all. So you can know this. But those who are engaged in this contingency plan say you cannot know for sure that problems won't arise in reality. And I say you can know for sure. So that is the point of divergence. From that point, there has to be a divergence. Now, of course, when you're coming out of this long survival game scenario, you're going to still think, well, maybe it might be needed, I'm not sure. And you're going to be somewhat ambivalent, of course. But you're gravitating towards accepting that you can know for sure that reality and that you'll never need this contingency plan. You're gravitating towards that. But within, there's some doubts, but it's just all that matters is you're more certainty than doubt. And then you gravitate. You really gravitate. It's like, let's say you're on perfectly flat land and you can't coast on flat land. If it's a hill, you can't go up. But if it's downhill, you can start coasting downhill. So if you tip it like this, you can just start coasting in that direction. You can start gravitating that way and you'll be going great, going towards certitude. So Christmas Day is, of course, commemorating the birth into this world of an appearance which was used as a communication device to reassure the world of the truth, that truth is true, that this hypothetical scenario contingency plan is totally unnecessary. This is a totally unnecessary hypothetical scenario contingency plan. None of it's necessary, and that there's this intermediate step back, and all this killing that you're doing of bodies doesn't touch the spirit in any way. So it was a very powerful witnessing to the world, very powerful reassurance that has been used in many, many ways throughout history, some ways better than others, for sure. Because people are so ambivalent here. Almost at the very best, there's a few that are working through their ambivalence. It's not easy to work through that because, again, we don't feel certain. We think, well, if we're not certain, we better go with this hypothetical and get a contingency plan. And then we can say, okay, let's go back to truth because we got this and we got this emergency plan in place. And that seems to be like very reasonable, and though, in fact, it's not. It's not reasonable at all. It's not easy to see that this is not reason at all. Not at all. Either truth can be changed or it can't. It's one or the other. So which is it? That's the question, right? If it can be changed, and a contingency plan seems to make sense, although it actually doesn't, because if reality was changed, everything would be annihilated. There'd be nothing at all. There'd be no need for anyone to have a contingency plan. But it's either one or the other. So it can't be both. So certitude has to be possible. It has to be one or the other. So it is one or the other. And then you have to determine which it is, and you can actually then work knowing that there must be a certitude. So you don't need a contingency plan if reality cannot be changed. So if within your deepest honesty you say, I really see that reality can't be changed, then that's a certitude. You don't need a contingency plan, and you gradually gravitate that way. So we had a couple thousand years ago, 2012 years ago, supposedly, date-wise, we had an appearance coming in the world which was dedicated to reassuring the world about the situation here and the truth of the situation, which was a great thing. And they called him Jesus Christ, Yeshua, and whatever terminology. Some people prefer this, that, whatever. It's just a reassurer of truth, of certitude. And that this Christmas season now has become about just about a lot of other things besides this. which is spending time basically reassuring ourselves that this contingency plan is necessary and we should keep going on it. So it's kind of the opposite of what Jesus really wanted to convey here. It's kind of been twisted over all these centuries. Feeling very commercialized, pretty much just hanging out with family and friends, which in most cases are simply spending time reinforcing a life of delay, a futile life, a life directed towards death, a life directed towards survival challenges, and not at all with any escape velocity at all. Not at all. People have even done away with prayers before meals, etc. I don't see anybody doing that. I still do it, but I haven't seen anybody else doing it. It's just amazing, amazing how far we have fallen away from at least challenging our ambivalence. Nowadays, we're trying to celebrate our ambivalence, saying this ambivalence is it. This is the highest thing. We've come out of believing in lies, and now we're believing in ambivalence, you see, and that's it. But ambivalence is the greatest lie of all. It's the most misleading lie of all. This indeterminateness, this ambivalence thing, let's celebrate this. That's the most stuckness at all. It leads to depression, which is why so many people in the world at this Christmas will be also taking with their Christmas ham or turkey or whatever, yams. They'll be taking their Prozac, they'll be taking their antidepressants, they'll be taking all their medications, which is trying to keep them stable enough so they can continue on to another year. Celebrating ambivalence, that is not the way that Christmas is supposed to be. Christmas is supposed to remind us that of certitude, and that there was one that came into the world who was absolutely certain, perfect certitude, and said this ambivalence is not the way, this indeterminance is not the way. And so one day out of the year, we want to celebrate certitude, and we don't do it. And this, come on. Hopefully this video is going. I don't know. This program has been seizing up recently, and the connection has been crashing. Okay, we're back. So one day out of the year, why can't we not celebrate certitude? And turn that, we can't even do that anymore. You go to church and you get this watered down stuff, and it's just it's really like preschool stuff, really. What do you do if you're a graduate student? Why are you hanging out in preschool if you're a graduate student? This is going to church is like preschool stuff. It's very, very carefully handling the ambivalence of everybody, just, you know, mollycoddling it. They don't want to drive anybody away because they're dependent on all the money that comes in from parishioners, of course. So they're stuck in a situation where they can't really come on strong at all, because the ambivalence of people would cause them to just flee. They just flee. They'd leave. Already, a ton of people have left the churches because of that. They want to celebrate ambivalence even more, and the church seemed to say, "Well, don't celebrate it too much. Let's also look at certitude." And people say, "Ah, forget it. We want ambivalence. Let's celebrate it." So they have to tread very carefully now, very carefully, and they do. And so maybe the priest can slip in one or two little tidbits, trying to at least say, "Here, you know, here's a little bone for you to chew on." But the rest of the stuff is just preschool stuff. And we deserve way better than preschool stuff. We deserve graduate school stuff, which is what these videos are conveying, is graduate school stuff. Time to graduate, trying to choose a new idea, time to experience the overlay, time to exchange hypothetical scenarios, time to realize and accept we've never been here, and no one's ever been here, and nothing's ever been here, and that nothing has ever happened here. Time to accept it. Time to allow the grace of God to move, to surround you, to be embraced by the grace of God here in this world, where survival is not an issue for your communication device, for your appearance here. Your appearance here is com- taken care of and protected perfectly well, perfectly healthy, perfectly capable of communicating and reassuring everyone. It's time for that. And that's graduate school stuff. And you're not going to hear that when you go to church. You will not hear that anywhere in this world. You will not. So I said, well, I guess I have to do these videos then. I wish I could be, you know, doing more. And I wish that everywhere in the world people could go to church or somewhere, a place of worship, and hear the graduate school stuff. But no way. Not even close. It's all preschool stuff. Very much so. Nothing wrong with that, but we don't want to remain preschoolers forever, do we? We don't want to be on the little toy pony forever. We want to get on a real horse, ride the horse, you know. Come on. Let's go. Let's get it going. And of course, the survival games are going to get going very soon. In full on, it's like an Olympiad, so to speak. It's the bimillennial Olympiad, or the 26,000 year Olympiad here. The survival Olympiad is about ready to open up with bomb circumstance, and people will, most of the world will relish this opportunity to have their survival challenged in very severe ways. I don't relish it at all. I don't want to participate in it at all. Not at all. Doesn't interest me. Survival games just simply don't interest me. So I'm trying to gravitate as quickly as possible to being taken care of by the grace of God, which is possible in this world, so I don't have to participate in those survival games. And I hope that I accept that, and but I don't know. I really don't know. I can't say for sure, because I thought years and years and years ago I would be in a better situation, but no. So it's hard to understand why things go the way they do in this world. It's based on, I guess, on our ambivalence and our attachments and deep-seated situations that we just can't quite free ourselves from. It takes time. It keeps a lot of work to gradually extricate ourselves from a dualistic situation. We're trying to please everybody, trying to please both those who don't want to exchange hypothetical scenarios and those who do, trying to please them both, and you can't really do it. You can't really please both at all. And so at some point you have to realize that your reassurance isn't going to reach everybody right now. It will eventually help everyone, but it may seem that it's not being very helpful in the world, because most people right now are saying, yeah, but we want to go on with this survival game scenario because we want to do it both. We want to have it all. We want to have truth plus the contingency plan. And of course, what I'm saying is you can't have both. It's impossible. Absolutely impossible. On many, many, many levels, it's completely impossible. Because, well, we've gone over and over and over that, and we'll have to continue it. But it is, the point is, you can't please both. You cannot please both. And the attempt to do so keeps one in harm's way, keeps one within the survival scenario so that people can relate to you. If I was in a situation where I was completely protected and couldn't be harmed, and my survival wasn't being threatened, and I could really speak out and do what I want to do, then people who are into survival games wouldn't listen. They wouldn't listen. But by presenting myself as someone who's very much trapped and very much downtrodden, etc., then people who are into survival games might listen. They say, yeah, looks like you're facing some real severe survival issues, so we're interested in what you have to say. But then when they hear what you have to say, they say, we're not interested in that. That's crazy. So it doesn't work. It doesn't work. You can't trick anybody here. You can't trick them. So you just have to decide one way or the other. Which way are you going? Which way are you going? Not two ways. You can't please them both. So that's been my great struggle, is to realize I cannot help everybody here right now. Cannot. And those who are into survival games will identify you as you're not one part of them, so they won't listen at all. And trying to trick them and saying you're one of them when you're really not, just so they'll listen, doesn't work either. Doesn't work. They'll just feel like you've wasted their time. They say, to heck with them. They just wasted my time. So I have to go all in. If you want to be a true effective teacher here, you have to go all in and accept protection, the grace of God protecting you. In other words, you don't have survival issues. You have to accept that. And then, of course, most people will reject you and reject what you have to say and won't even listen at all. But down the, but they will feel some sort of reassurance, and down the road in their survive, their play of this hypothetical scenario, that reassurance will start. The seed will be planted. It will start to grow, and they'll say, "Hey, I think I can get out of this. I think I can get out of this." Something deep within will register it. It's just that it won't show up. And the seed is planted, but it's slow germinating, very slow germinating for most people. But as Jesus said, you scatter the mustard seeds, and some fall on fertile soil, some fall on rocky, infertile soil, some falls on just rocks that it just doesn't germinate at all, seemingly. But the wind keeps blowing, and eventually the seeds get into a little bit of soil. I mean, we have pavers that, whether there's weeds and plants keep growing up through the cracks of the pavers. I don't know how they do it. What are they living on? There's nothing there. They're living on water, really. There's no soil at all. They just live on water. It's really amazing. They somehow get some nutrients through the water. I don't know how. But so seeds, it will eventually help everyone, but it won't appear that way. So that's something that's difficult to accept, that you come in the world, you try to do your best, and it doesn't seem like you're helping hardly anybody. But that is the case, and that is something I have to accept, that you can't help everybody, can't please everyone here. Really can't, and it's very stark, very delineated. And of course people will say, "Hey, you're not really compassionate because you're not trying to help us." And you have to put up with that too. And you can't fall into that trap of saying, "Okay, I'll take on survival issues so you can feel that I'm being compassionate towards you and trying to help you." Because again, there is no way to come up with an answer in this hypothetical scenario of how to survive annihilation. There is no answer to it, because there is no annihilation. If there was, there wouldn't be any answer. So it's a lose-lose, impossible situation from the very beginning. And the only way to help is to reassure it's not necessary. That's the only way. It's not helping bring world peace. That doesn't help anybody. Doesn't help anyone. That's a temporary at best, because then they'll say, "Wait a minute. Where's the challenge to my survival? Where's the annihilation challenge? I need to grow. I need to get better at it. So this peace in the world's terrible. It's stifling me. Let's shake it up. Let's stir it up. Let's get some turmoil going. Let's get some conflict going." That's exactly what will happen. So all peace in this world is only temporary. It's just a temporary lull in between sets of crises, like waves. You're out on the ocean surfing, and waves come in sets. Sets of three, sets of four, whatever, it comes rolling in, and then there's a lull, and then there's another set, and there's a lull, another set. It's like that. So that's how the world is. That's how existence is. So you cannot spend your time praying for world peace, and for those who want to do that, fine. I cannot be part of that. They want to play their music and chant and dance and say we're attuning everything, we're bringing it all into alignment with the cosmic mother, cosmic father, we're bringing all this, let them do that. I can't be part of any of that, because that only makes things worse. Actually, it only makes things worse, because it's celebrating indeterminacy. Really, it's also celebrating the belief that somehow we can make this indeterminacy perfect, and this will be our perfect home, and that we're actually here, and there's actually something taking place. It's reinforcing all of that, reinforces it. Whereas you get some guy up in a flat in Bombay, Sri Nisargadatta, who's just hanging out there in his little flat and saying, "Hey, nothing's here, nobody's here." You get these teachers that are just totally adamant. It's my life. I've had to play the cowardly lion my entire life. It's just a show. It's just a facade. It's just a sham. The cowardly lion who's too afraid to say anything and timidly saying, "Oh yeah, I'm so threatened by all this. Existence is so threatening to me. I don't know how I'm going to survive. I have to play this just so I can hope that I can get close enough to people so that I can say something to them and speak with them." Whereas if I were the roaring lion of certitude, which I should be, people would flee from me and say, "Oh, that guy's so scary, I'm not going to get within a million miles of him. I never want to listen to the thing he says. He's terrifying." That's what they'll say. But this way, it's a cowardly lion, I can get close. But when you try to help, they'll look at you like, "What? What are you talking about? Are you crazy?" Yeah. So it's just a waste of time. Just wasting my time, wasting their time. Stupid. But again, it comes from compassion that is ill-informed. The heart needs to be informed by the head. It's very important. Heart by itself can be very foolish, very foolish indeed, and come to very erroneous conclusions. You have to have the clarity that comes from seeing the totality of the situation, and your compassion has to be informed by truth, by pragmatism, by the situation, what it really is, and you cannot just over love bomb people or overwhelm them with love in the heart. It doesn't work that way. You have to understand that people are terrified by dropping this hypothetical scenario. They you cannot try to love them into it because it just doesn't work. They really have to, their path has to develop from within. And you can reassure them, but their own path has to develop from within, like it's organic, something that belongs to them, and they have to follow that path and see for themselves and clarify for themselves that the non-necessity of this. There's no, and if you try to just love them into it and bypass all of that, it makes things worse. It delays them, actually. So it's better just to speak the truth, and for those who want to hear it, they can hear it, and for those who don't want to hear it, they don't hear it. But that takes an ego-less teacher. Teacher has no ego at all. No, nothing invested. That's very difficult. It has to take absolute certitude in order to teach effectively in this world. Absolute certitude. Anything less than that, and the teaching gets problematic. Not that if you don't have absolute perfect certitude that you cannot teach. That is, you can reassure. But the problematic nature of it is there, and one has to be very careful and tread very carefully, and mistakes can be made. They can be made. You get a perfect teacher with perfect certitude that they don't make mistakes. They don't. It's effortless for them, absolutely effortless. But even after we choose a different hypothetical scenario of non-annihilation, we still have to get familiar and used to that, and then set that down as well. But we can, once we choose this, we can be helpful, we can be reassuring. But it's not like we're flawless in our execution of this reassurance. We still might let the heart lead and think that we can help others when they're asking us for help. What they're really doing is they're asking us to bring peace to the world, which is not helpful at all for them. If they really wanted peace, why wouldn't they want to recognize that they're not even here, and this is and exchange hypothetical scenarios? One second here. Just one second. Just have to go over to this. All right, we're back. So it's a tricky thing. It is a tricky thing because everybody wants to be happy. They want peace. They want peace. They want peace. But it's a very superficial thing. They want, what they want is have their cake and eat it too. They want to keep working on this contingency plan. It's just they want a little break. They want a little vacation from it. That's not what teachers are here for. Teachers are here to tell you work every day on contemplating truth. Every day. Give it everything you got. Not here for some vacation from that. And those who come and say, oh, just give me a hug. I just want to have a little vacation from all the stress and et cetera. They're not giving up their contingency plan. What they say is that, whoa, they're really tired. And they think that you're here to just like to cheer them on to do better, to succeed at this contingency plan. That's not the case at all. We're saying you cannot succeed at it. Totally impossible. It's completely futile. But everyone in the world will, if they say you're a teacher, oh, okay, reassure me, teacher, that I can succeed, is what they're saying. And I say, no, you cannot. And they say, what are you talking about? You're terrifying me. It's not easy. It is not easy. And you just have to, we all have to go down that path. I have to do it. I'm trying here, but it gets, if you're interacting with people, it gets real difficult. Real difficult. It gets more tempestuous because people become very demanding and they act out their demands, and they get very clingy and very you got to help me, you got to help me, you got to get some of this suffering off of me. So the suffering is causing me to not be functioning in optimum level. And what they mean by functioning optimal level is being better at survivability, being able to be more artful in their lives and make their survivability seem like the art of living more successful, more beautiful, more successful, like more effortless to survive here, as if they're surviving annihilation. But they're not allowing the grace of God to protect their appearance in all ways. No, they're not. They're trying to do it themselves, find a way to do it themselves. So that's not a teaching situation. That what happens is a misleading situation, and you have to tell them that's not it. But it's not easy to do that. People get frustrated and angry and say, you said you're here to help me, but you're not helping me. And you have to say, no, yes, I'm here to reassure you that you don't need to find an answer to how to survive. You can exchange hypothetical scenarios. And you don't need to work for world peace. Don't try to force peace on people. So that's what I've learned in this life. It's amazing that the people, they want the difficulties, they want the challenges. What they want is they want to get their head beaten in, and then they want to get healed from it so they can get their head beaten in again. So they want doctors, they want healers. They want healers to heal their wounds so they can go at the battle again. That's not what a teacher does. That's not what a teacher is here for. It's not that they're, if someone is healed, that's fine. But they're not here to heal anything, not here to bring peace to the world. Jesus said they didn't come to bring peace to the world, to save the world. They came to condemn it, meaning this whole scenario is unnecessary, totally unnecessary. And to reassure that this is certain, it's absolutely certain it's unnecessary. Without that reassurance, there is no teaching, really. And different teachers have different levels of reassurance. So some reassure mildly, some stronger, and then some are like super reassurers. They're just like, wow. And people just have their minds just like blown, just like, whoa. This is incredible. And then they kind of back off and say, I don't quite need that much reassurance. That's a little too much reassurance, because I might just accept it. And then what would happen? Are they just not ready for it? They're not ready for that super reassurance, which means exchange hypothetical scenarios and be in bliss, and their appearance here would be totally protected, and nothing could harm it, and it would just, everything would go as totally smoothly, and there'd just be no trouble whatsoever. And they would realize they don't need to do anything to bring peace to this world, that nobody's even in the world. Everyone is still, as always, in reality, which is perfectly peaceful, perfectly untroubled, perfectly blissful, perfectly invulnerable, non-threatened, eternal, can't be changed, can't be annihilated in any way. Everybody's already in that condition. So what do you need to do except reassure them that it'll always be that way? Because if they're not reassured it'll always be that way, they will continue to work on this contingency plan, which is futile, which causes endless suffering. And we're called to witness, to reassure, to be reassurers. Jesus Christ, the birthday of today, Christmas, calls us all to be reassurers like he was, as do all the great reassurers throughout history who have appeared here, who knew they weren't here. Those who knew they weren't here and knew that nobody's here, but appeared in the dream anyway with appearance to mingle with the appearances of all the other, those who believe they are here, to mingle and talk into these dream figures, reassuring that spirit that these dream figures aren't needed. But there's a plan to maintain the dream figures with the grace of God and the hypothetical of non-annihilation, to simply use these bodies as a reference point of reassurance, as a communication device. That's all that they really are. So Jesus said we have to be like him. We have to be like him. We have to be reassurers. And we can. Absolutely can. All of us have to do. We all have to be like Buddha, like Jesus, like Ananda Mahima. We all have to be that way. All of us. Eventually. And so we're called to that. We're called to that. Because we haven't left reality either. So in reality, we're all one. There's no higher or lower in reality. In reality, we're the same as Jesus, Buddha, Ananda Mahima. We're the same. We're all one. We're all flawless. We're all perfectly free. There's no difference whatsoever. It's just that they know that reality will always be this way, and we're not sure. We think maybe it'll change. And we're not sure why we think it will change. It's because we chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. That's why, which would necessitate a change. And so we want it to change. We desire it to change, which gives rise to the fear of annihilation and the contingency plan to survive it. Whereas Jesus, Anandamayi, Buddha, etc., they know reality cannot change. They're absolutely certain of it. That's the only difference. It's the only difference between us and them. No other difference. And as they call us to certitude, we gravitate towards certitude to eventually be the same as they are, just like them. And the style of our reassurance will be the style of the times, whatever fits the times, so we'll appear to be different, but we'll really be the same. We'll have absolute certitude. That's eventually. But when you meet those super reassurers, it's like, whoa, I'm not sure I want to be reassured that much. It's not easy. So sometimes these intermediate reassurers are helpful too. But it's not easy for them because they're tempted to be unwise, really. But I'm just a mid-level reassurer who's working to become a high-level reassurer. And maybe I'll be a high mid-level at some point. Maybe that's the next step, is to be a high mid-level. If there is such a thing, probably is. I don't know how I could be a super reassurer right now. It's theoretically as possible, but practically, I wouldn't expect it. I would not expect that. It would be a surprise to me. Really, it would. But a high level, high mid level, yeah, that's the next step for me, is a high mid level reassurer, or maybe a low high level reassurer, which may be the same thing. I don't know. <It's>, That's what I'm looking for at this Christmas time, is to make that, whoops, just dropped out. It's still going though, isn't that something? It's very buggy, this program these days. Early this morning it crashed, but it's back. So what I'm looking for this Christmas and next year, 2013, is to be that high mid-level or low high-level reassurer, and then to keep gravitating up towards maybe a mid-high level and then a high level kind of situation eventually. Certainly, that's what I'm on track for, because I've been paying attention to the great reassurers and believing and not accepting what they had to say. I said, this is true. I know it's true. I just can't quite accept it entirely, but I know it's true what they're saying. And when you pay attention to the high-level reassurers, then you're on the fast track. You're really on the fast track. There are some mid-level reassurers in the world. There are some high mid-level reassurers in the world. And when I see them, I say, they're not high-level reassurers. They're not. But I see that they are helpful, and they reassure to a certain extent. But I wish we had something better. Not that we need the mid-levels. We do. I'm not down on any teachers in the world. We need the mid-level teachers. I'm not down on myself. I'm just a mid-level. We need the high mid-level. We need the low high level, the mid high level, and the high level. We need it all. Because a lot of people are so ambivalent, they have a trouble with the real high, super high level reassurers. They just say, well, I just got to worship you. That's all I can do. I'm afraid, so I need to just cling to you or something. And can you not come to our country and pray for world peace or something? It's tough for them. It's tough for them to handle that. So we need it all, but we need to continue to upgrade to get better reassurance. Better reassurance is better, really. It's very helpful, very helpful. The more reassurance we have in the world, the better. And at some point, it may be that there's some divergency takes place, where those who are really intent on survival, continuing their survival games, will decide to split off and go to a place where there's no reassurers. And those who are really intent on exchanging hypothetical scenarios and accepting reality as it is, will go to a place where that is totally supported, very heavily supported. So that's called a parting of the ways divergency, and it's likely to take place now, because it seems in this world there is this extreme polarization, really, and it's getting worse and worse and worse and stronger and stronger and stronger. So for those who really want the high level reassurance. It seems like there's some and they really want it, and the others, they don't want it at all. They want to really get into the survival game. So extreme divergence right now. The middle ground, the sitting on the fence, the ambivalence is getting less and less and less and less. And there, of course, there are those who want to celebrate their ambivalence, which those generally go to what's called the fourth dimension. If you don't want, you want to, just for the sake of conversation, we go 3D, 4D, 5D. It's just a way to talk. 3D is for those like who really want to pursue their survival games in a very, very intense way. 4D is for those who want to celebrate their ambivalence, but they will still be faced with all sorts of survival crises. They hope not. They just want to celebrate ambivalence as if that's it. And then 5D is for those who are very intent on accepting reality as it is. That honk just signified, yeah, that's the one. That's the one, 5D. High 5D would be the paradise realms, the death-free realms. They're probably lower for 5D realms that are not, where there's not a complete absence of threat. I'm not sure about that, but it would make sense. I wouldn't be surprised if that was the case. But high 5D would be the paradise death-free realms. Or you could call it 6D if you wanted to, whatever, differentiate. But I would see it that those who want to gravitate towards accepting reality as it is, to recognizing the total non-necessity of any contingency plan to survive annihilation, they would have a scenario situation where they would have a situation of much, much less threat, very limited, low-level threat, where so they can then focus on dropping even that threat. Whereas those who believe very strongly in this contingency plan is necessary, want a situation that is full of severe threat. And there are those who are ambivalent who say, well, we're smarter than everybody. We don't need either one. Let's just celebrate our ambivalence or indeterminism. Those are the 4D people, those who go to 4D. Those are the scientists and the humanists, those kind of people who go to 4D, who are really into healing modalities and all these light and sound and healing modalities. They go to the 4D and kind of, we're going to build a utopia. Those are the utopianists who have a false utopia. There's the dystopics, who go to the 3D, super threatening situation. The what you call the faux utopians, who try to build a perfect world, as it were, and make existence perfect. And then there's the true utopians, who are going towards 5D, where the high 5D is the death-free realms, the threat-free realms, no problem-free, death-free realms. Totally blessed realms. And so, super big difference, isn't there, between 5D, 4D, and 3D. And so there's a stratification taking place now. And we will see that stratification in 2013 is probably the year where that stratification will really, the different dimensions, as it were, will separate. The separation will begin of those, some people call it timeline separating, whatever, it's purpose. The separation of purpose will begin. And how that will play out, I don't know. But we'll find out. We'll find out. And again, for those who are oriented towards 5D, it won't be problematic. They will find themselves in much less threatening situations. And their threats will get less and less and less and less and less. Whereas those in 4D will find themselves becoming more and more isolated from 5D and 3D. And they're focused on utopian ideals of how to concoct the perfect society, the perfect civilization, which is generally be super regulated, super controlled. They're control freaks, essentially. The faux utopians are control freaks. The dystopians are what's called super individual, rugged wild, wild west types. You know, let's just live and let live, and let's the survival of the fittest, and let's get it on. And again, we don't judge any of that. They're perfectly free to do what they want to do, and I don't feel any less love towards them as anyone else, towards 5D, 4D, 3D. No. The play is being done, carried out by those who have not left reality at all, just like I haven't, and you haven't, no one has. So what is there to hate? Nothing. If they want to pursue a completely unnecessary contingency plan, they're free to do so. And the way they do it, if they want to do different styles, let them do it. There's no problem. But we have, of course, every right to choose 5D. Every right to do so. And we will do so. So continue off this Christmas message, which just tried to, something's been trying to crash this repeatedly, hasn't been able to. Maybe that's a sign. That's maybe 4D is trying to crash it. Maybe 3D is trying to crash it, trying to cut this off. You say, we don't want this in our 4D. None of this stuff in 4D. Well, fine. I'm not going to come to 4D and ruin your faux-utopian efforts. But eventually, you will find yourself going back into 3D and saying, whoa, this didn't work, and then meddling in 3D and enmeshing yourself in 3D, like the Zeta Reticulans, etc. Those are beings who have been in 4D for quite some time and trying to build perfect societies, and it didn't work, and now here they are enmeshing themselves back in 3D so they can go through all this horrendous kind of experiences, and they're trying to learn how to survive from the 3D humans who are survivalists. They say, how are they surviving? Oh, they're real emotional, they're real violent, they're real protective, they're real defensive, they attack, they shoot, they fight, and the ETs are looking at this like, oh, that's how you do it, okay, that's how you survive. Crazy stuff, isn't it? It's really weird, really bizarre, but that's all taking place. And of course, those who are going to 5D don't want to pay attention to any of that stuff. They're not interested in how to survive. They're not interested in survival games. They're interested in dwelling in a place where they're not threatened. See, it's totally different. Everyone else wants to say, yeah, we dwell in a super hostile environment, but we're safe. The 4D says, yeah, the universe is very dangerous, but we figured out a way to protect ourselves and we're safe. And we kept up the perfect plan to protect ourselves from all the different disasters that can happen. Whereas 3D says, we can survive at all these disasters because we're tough. We're really tough. We're really clever. We're really ingenious. We're really tough. And we'll make other people suffer from it, but not us. That kind of thing. Service to self. And then the 4D is like service to others. Yeah, we found out a perfect way. We all cooperate and we can protect ourselves from these threats. Whereas 5D says, threats? What threats? We don't see any threats. There are no threats here. That's the difference. See, huge difference. So of course, as a teacher, I'm orienting you to 5D. As a mid-level, 5D is where it's at, if you want it. I'm just saying that's the option. Like, threat? What threat? There's no threats here. Everything's perfect. We're not threatened by anything. It's not anything we're doing. We just decide it's the grace of God that is giving us this scenario, because we realize we never left reality. We don't need any contingency plan. Reality can never be annihilated. We don't need a contingency plan. So we're just getting used to dropping the contingency plan. That's all. We don't need any threats. We don't need any survival strategies. We're just enjoying. We're blissful, very blissful. Very delightful, or full of gratitude and delight. That's 5D. 5D has this, you can't call it heart, way people say heart here. No, it's beyond that. It's just like this radiant gratitude and feeling of safety and freedom and just relishing this, just abiding in it, relishing the abidance in it. So happy and radiantly grateful for it. And it's beyond heart, it's beyond head, really is. It's beyond energy. You don't have to talk about it in those terms at all. It's grace. You're just living, abiding in grace, in the grace of God. It's not masculine, it's not feminine, it's not anything like that. You're just not threatened. Nothing's threatened. It's not only you that's not threatened, it's your entire environment is not threatened. There's no threat to anything anywhere. And wow, I'm telling you, the feeling you have is just, you cannot get that feeling here in this world. You really cannot. Unless you accept the overlay of this world. Whereas we see I spent, the day cleaning up junk leaves, branches that fell. The storm was strong and knocked down all sorts of debris everywhere. And I was watching this tree during the storm, and it was like, I said, I hope it doesn't crash and fall over. It just, woo. Intense winds. I'm well scared. I'm saying, oh, please, tree, don't fall over. I'm praying that it doesn't fall over. And I'm seeing all these plants here. I say, please don't die. Please plant. I hope you bloom nicely. You grow nicely. And you don't die. You don't get sick. Because plants, all of a sudden, they'll just die on you. Or these plants here, they got hit by the frost. We had hard frost. Several nights, it was 30 degrees. And a lot of plants died. I was cleaning up all the dead plants the last couple of days, pulling them out. I said, oh, I'm so sad, plant, you died. I wish you had kept blooming. And the ones that bloom, I said, oh, I'm so glad you survived. And so it's traumatic for me. This world's traumatic. No matter what you do, it's traumatic because it's harsh. Whereas in the high 5D, the death-free paradise realms, Nothing is threatened in any way. You don't have to pray for the survival of plants or say, I better put some fertilizer. Is it getting enough water? Nothing like that. Nothing like that. All you have to do is just simply appreciate the beauty. You just sheer appreciation of the beauty and presence and just say, ah, I'm so glad that you're not threatened, plant, and I don't have to do anything. I don't have to clean up after you. I don't have to clean up all the dead debris. And I have to protect you from the frost. I don't have to do any of that stuff. I don't have to water you all the time. All I have to do is just sheer enjoy the beauty of your presence here. That's it. So, huge difference between 3, 4, and 5D. Huge, huge difference. You can't have them both. You can't dwell. Well, I want to dwell in 3D, 4D, and 5D simultaneously. That's impossible. Because if you dwell in 3D, everything's threatened. You dwell in 4D, everything's also threatened, but you think you're hell-bent on a plan to give the appearance that it's not all okay. In other words, how to protect it all. You think you got the answer. You're like super arrogant, intellectually arrogant, thinking that you just regulate everything. You have all these systems, super sophisticated technological systems. Everything gets the right water. Everything gets the right nutrition. All the bugs are killed. And you figure out how to make it all flawless, et cetera, et cetera. And the soil's just right. And you think you're so smart until you can protect the planet from radiation. And a lot of 4D is underground, actually. A lot of 4D civilizations are underground. Maybe most of them. Because underground they can control their environment more easily, and they've figured out ways. A lot of planets are pretty hollow, a lot of space under the surface, and they tap the energy. They figure out how to tap the energy of the core, of the dynamics of gravity, all this stuff, and they have all this so-called free energy, and they're able to have these hydroponics and greenhouses and control the environment, atmosphere, and all that kind of stuff of 4D. Protect themselves from the radiation, cosmic radiation, etc., etc. But what they don't understand is there's a sickness comes from within them. It's somehow that they feel so unhappy. And they're controlling everything, and yet they can't control themselves. They can't control their own unhappiness. They have all this genetic engineering and all these medications and all this stuff, and they think they should be able to control them. And for some reason, they have this ennui, this terrible, terrible ennui that just says, I just feel like homesick. There's some kind of homesickness, and they can't get rid of it, and it just bedevils them, and then they start gravitating towards 3D, basically. And of course, their lives are just hellishly regulated. Everybody's policing everybody else, and they're constantly monitoring their systems. They monitor their systems. They're monitoring the monitors, and on and on and on. They make sure the supercomputers work appropriately, and of course they got to protect themselves from attacks from other 4D who are 3D, and it's just a nightmare for them. Kind of like they just can't quite get it right, and their arrogance is such that it just drives them crazy. Drives them crazy. So it's really wretched. 4D is just wretched. So is 3D, of course. But 3D is not experienced as so depressing and wretched, and the men are not so bad. But 3D, you just get your head hacked off, and that's it. Whereas 4D, you think you're all perfect, and you feel that you're not, and you can't figure out why, and it just drives you crazy. So 4D is beset with mental problems, mental illnesses. Terrible stuff. Oh, awful. And they long for 3D. Oh, God, 3D feels so much better than 4D. They don't have these mental illnesses. They just say, there's the threat, and it's kill or be killed. and if you kill, you survive. It's, yay, I'm a hero. And it's very simple. Where truly the real remedy is 5D, of course, is the death-free paradise realms, where there's no threat to anything. Because the fact is that all of this is entirely unnecessary, and we've never left reality, and that's a fact, that's truth, and that's within us. Truth is within us, and we keep being reminded of it, and we can't get rid of it. We can't shake it. No matter how many drugs we take, it's still there. Drugs can't touch it. So you can take in all these drugs and genetic modification, DNA, blah blah, this and that, doesn't touch it. Doesn't touch truth. Doesn't touch reality. It's still there, and we know that this is all a sham. Excuse me. Almost a sneeze there. So eventually everybody has to go, has to accept 5D, and everything else is just a delay, just a waste of time. If you're still hanging out in 3D or 4D, it's just a waste of time. Let me adjust the light just a little bit here. It's getting a little bit dark because the sun is setting. Just as the sun is setting on this year, very quickly, we're getting to the end of it. And 2013 is going to be, has to be, the separation of the of these 3D, 4D, and 5D, because it's becoming so super polarized. I mean, I'm going to go for 5D all out, definitely. And I'm going to advise everybody that comes within, if my situation allows it. Right now, it doesn't allow it to go all out, because I'm still with those who are headed towards 4D, basically. Silicon Valley's 4D all the way. It's the heart of 4D. It's how 4D seeded itself and grew into in this world, Silicon Valley. That's 4D all the way. And I was here in my whole life in this situation, just hating it, absolutely hating it. But somehow I felt like 4D people, the only people would listen to what I had to say. So I felt I needed to find some way to talk to them. I found it was futile, absolutely futile. They're even more resistant than 3D. Well, 3D is very resistant. 3D just will listen, but they don't understand what you're talking about. 4D won't even listen because they're so intellectually arrogant. They say, you don't know what you're talking about. You're crazy. So that's futile too. So it's there's some 4D people and some 3D people who are willing to go to 5D. But it's not like you can hang out in Silicon Valley and be a successful teacher. There's not a bunch of people here. Nah, it's not the case at all. Not the case at all. There are a few teachers that have hung out here, Adya Shanti, and a few others. I think like John Wheeler, and there are others. I don't know how successful they've been, but they also move around a lot. They travel all over the world because they're trying to pick up and harvest a few people here, a few people there. That's really how it is. And for some reason, I haven't been able to do that at all, because of whatever, for whatever reason. But definitely, you cannot hang out in 4D and get a lot of people listen to what you have to say. No way. No way. They think they know it all already. And they're just saying, well, yeah, where's your control system? What's your control system like? And I say, what control system? Just complete disconnect. There's futile, 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 futile. So hopefully I get to hang out somewhere else. Meaning I can be more adamant, full on. I need to be full on 5D now. I cannot do that here. If I'm full on 5D in Silicon Valley, people will think I'm crazy, completely arrogant. They'll think that I'm the arrogant one, I'm the conceited one. How dare I dismiss 4D like that and say it's all completely unnecessary. They just think I'm absolutely off the charts, conceited and arrogant. To a dangerous extent, as it were, because I seem to be threatening the principles of 4D. So that can't really do it here. Can't really be full-on adamant here. So I'm hoping there's some place in the world I can be that is 5D, full-on 5D. Some will say, well, Sedona or something like that. Sedona is 4D. It's like high 4D. It's also celebrating ambivalence, that kind of thing, which is a slightly different dimension of 5D, of 4D, different 4D, or high 3D, or something like that. It's not 5D at all. It's not fifth dimensional stuff. It's trying to make it is utopian in its own way. It's part of 4D. Is also, but it's the healing modality part of 4D. Let's get all these. It's the wedding of science and spirituality. That's 4D. When you hear that, that's 4D all the way. The marriage, the integration of science and religion, or science and spirituality, the integration of that, that's 4D. That's 4D. 5D, you don't need any science whatsoever, none. You don't need any spirituality, none. You don't need any healing modalities, none. Nothing sick, nothing threatened. There's no threat to anything survival, and you're just completely blissed out. And with gratitude radiating, endless, eternal gratitude everywhere, universally. It's just effortless. There's no integration of science and religion or whatever. That's all 4D. So for me, like, Sedona is 4D. Although they would think that they're super, super high, I think. You know, high 5D or something. But no, it's not. Maybe there are elements of 5D there. I don't know. That's you know, one of the supposed spiritual hotspots of the planet. I've never been there, but I'm aware there's a lot of teachers that hang out there. I don't know if there's some mid-level teachers or whatever. Various, you know, ashrams. Muji has a place in Portugal somewhere now, and I don't know where Muji, where he falls in the spectrum, really. I don't really know. I would say he's like maybe a low high teacher type of thing, or a mid high teacher, something like that. He seems to be more than a mid level teacher, or he could be a high mid level. I'm not exactly sure. But he's helpful. He's helpful in his own way, very, very engaging way. And he's pretty full on. He's pretty full on, more full on than most. He's able to do it somehow. He has a charisma to be pretty full on and to be able to handle the negativity somehow. He doesn't seem to bother much, which is great, or as he would say it, very great. but the from my standpoint, it could be better. I'm sure he'll gravitate towards better and better and better and better. Absolutely. So the I don't know where there is in the world where there's really full on 5D, or where I could be more adamant and be full on and say, hey, let's full on gravitate towards 5D right now. I'm not sure where that could take place. It might even take place in a situation that's more 3D. Basically 4D is super problematical because people are very arrogant. They think they know it all, and when I talk this way, they say, "Well, you don't understand all these healing modes, and we got all this Reiki stuff, and we can align your chakras and all this stuff. You don't know that stuff." Well, okay, you need to listen to the teachers here, because you're not a real high level teacher or whatever. You don't know this stuff. And what I'd say, well, I don't need to know it. There's no need for me to know any of that stuff at all. So there's a disconnect between who's higher level teacher, as it were. There's a disconnect there. In 4D, they just don't see it. From my standpoint, I don't need to know any of that. Totally unnecessary. From their standpoint, it's super important. If you don't know it, you're not a very helpful teacher at all. So it might be, for me, that going to a high 3D situation is actually better, where people just shrug their shoulders, "I don't know what you're talking about," and whatever. Whatever. They don't really care. That might be better for me, actually. That's what I've been attracted to, is a high 3-level place, where the 4D people would look at that with scorn and say, "Ah, you're just a 3D materialist. You know, you're nothing." What actually might be more beneficial for me, actually, because then I could teach 5D very adamantly, and the 3D people there would just, "I don't know, he's kind of weird." Yeah. Whatever, but he seems like a kind of nice guy, and it's okay, and whatever. It doesn't really interest me anyway, so it's no big deal, and he doesn't seem to harm anybody or do anything. You know, he's okay, nice guy, you know, well, no big deal. That's 3D, like high 3D is like that. They're like that. And he says, "Well, you know, as long as I can live my life, live and let live, and not bother me, what the heck, I don't care." Whereas 4D are very, very arrogant, like, "Who's better? I'm a better teacher. You should listen to me." And it's very competitive, spiritually competitive, and it's very intense. They've got to integrate all this stuff, and they're very, all this stuff. And 5D teaching doesn't fly there. Doesn't fly at all. Because a lot of problems, a lot of stuff there that you would intrigue. Super ton of spiritual intrigue, all that stuff. Whereas 3D, nah. They just say, "Whatever. Not interested, but that's okay." And they can even have them over for tea. And they say, "Yeah, okay, it's cool. Nice place you got here." And then that's it. Not any great depth. They've been successful in surviving in 3D more than others, and playing that game. And again, I don't have any judgment on those people at all, any more than I have judgment on 4D. It's just very different. But I'm trying to say, what is pragmatically most helpful for 5D? It may be high 3D. That's where I've been attracted to. Or there might be some other place that is actual 5D. I don't know. I've never come across such a place. I really have not. I have not found a single place in this world that is high 5D, even low 5D. None. And yes, I'm aware of a lot of places. If there is one, it would be quite a surprise. It's probably pretty hidden, pretty much unknown. I might be. I might be. It's just nobody knows about it. Hardly, very few people know about it. So if that comes up, great. Otherwise, I'll go to High 3D. One of the two has to happen. I'm not going to 4D. I'm not going to be hanging out with the chakra people and the energy people and the healing people and all that stuff. I'm not going to be hanging out there. You're not going to see me holding the non-dual satsang with all the gopis and the sangha and the hugs and all this groovy stuff about, and yeah, I've got all this light colors and lights, and I've got all this healing energy, and I'm chanting, and I'm doing blah, 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 you know. Nah, forget it. Not even, none of that interests me in the slightest bit. The retreats. I'm not going to be a retreat, holding a retreat leader. Hey, holding some seminar and a retreat or something like that. Probably not. I mean, there may be some 5D retreats that would be effective. If so, maybe I would. But where to hang out, headquarters or something? Probably High 3D. And then from that place, there can be celebrations where people come. 5D people can come. Those who are oriented to 5D can come. And the 3D people would just say, well, whatever. You know, you're having a party celebration, so fine, okay. No big deal. No big deal. We'll mind our business. You mind your business, we'll mind our business. It's not a big issue at all. Just so long as you behave in a very ethical, moral, civilized fashion and conduct yourself in a proper manner, they don't care. They don't really care. As long as you got money, basically. I mean, as long as you got money, as long as you have money to be there, then that's it. They don't care. They don't really care. So as long as you don't scare the horses, as it were, it's not a big issue. Where 4D, everyone's saying, wait a minute, their satsang is, how come they're saying that? And that teacher says that. It gets very weird and wild and intense and just yuck. Yuck, 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 yuck. That's why I never hung out in those kind of 4D spiritual situations. Because I just said, intuitively, I just said, no way, no way, no how, no way. It's all so competitive, spiritually competitive. And if you try to come in and say, hey, this is 5D, forget about all this stuff. People say, who are you? Who are you? And different students try to take over the teaching in 4D. They really do. They go to the teacher and they find out a way to try to steal the students to some other teacher. And you have one teacher going to a satsang of another teacher and trying to steal the students away from that teacher. You have all the spamming on the websites. You have all the stuff saying, hey, why don't you go see this teacher or that teacher or that one? And you get in just total craziness of trying to each usurp and people get all, it's like a high school. It's like you're back in high school or something. I hated high school. Hated it. I didn't want to be in high school at all. I wanted to just quit school. I had no interest in high school whatsoever. The whole social scene is just madness to me. Absolute madness. Everybody, all these intrigues and all these, everybody's trying to clicks here and clicks there and oh, who's is that? Who's doing that? And this and all this. Nowadays, everybody's Twittering and Facebooking. Who's doing what, etc. I try to just say, well, I'll be Facebook, Twitter, whatever, if that's helpful for anybody. But the intrigues in 4D is just crazy. Very immature, very sophomoric, very high schoolish. And people simply are desperately struggling and clawing to get a higher position, to survive, better survival. I got this guru, and I got that one, I got this teacher, and oh, check this one out. And what are they saying? And wait a minute, you should read this book, or you should read that book, or you should be into this, or I'm into this, and ooh, it's like that, wow, oh gosh, 5D is totally different. If you want to see a super high level teacher, an Anamayama super high level teacher, just like you go there and say, holy cow, I think I just want to sit down and shut up. And there's no question of usurping any. Let me just sit down and shut up and enjoy this. Boom, that's it. I don't want to read anything. I don't want to chant. I don't want to do anything. I just want to, let me just, who's this? Oh my gosh, what is this? It's like, that's it. What is this? Forget about everything. Forget about the whole world. Forget about all threats. Forget about survival even. What in the world is this? This is from some completely other domain entirely. It's from heaven. This being came here from heaven, which is true. came here from reality. Or, of course, she didn't leave reality, but her appearance, she knew that her body was nothing but an appearance and she wasn't really here at all. In other words, this being is in knows that they're in heaven and that heaven will always be heaven. Reality will always be reality. They know it for certain. And just, what is that? And just, your mind just stops. And it's like, just your attention just comes super focused. That is high 5D. That's super high 5D. And the flavor of that is in 5D teaching. The flavor of that is there. You just come and just sit down and shut up. Or you just say, wow, there's certitude here. There's real certitude. And this is something different. This is different than 4D. Way different. And you automatically know how to conduct yourself. You realize this isn't high school anymore. I'm not in high school. It's not even college. This is graduate school. And you just automatically have this tremendous willingness to understand how to conduct yourself within the situation. And if you're reprimanded in any way, you take it in the right way. You absolutely say thank you, because this will help me hang with the situation. Thank you. Any corrections, you're willing to hear it and say thank you. If you say, hey, you know, let's not emphasize this, you say, okay. Done deal. You just told once, you got it. Just like that. It's easy. The 5D thought songs are easy. There's the 4D that are hell. You got all this stuff going on. You got all this circus going on. But in 5D on up, people are just, you realize, hey, wow, these people are conducting themselves in a very responsible manner. Why? Because they realize the opportunity. They want to. They say, holy cow, I'm being reminded of truth. This is my opportunity. It's here now. They're not going to blow that. Say, I don't want to blow this. No way. Let me. I know how to conduct myself. It's very simple. Boom. Done deal. If I need to leave, I leave. If I don't want to pester the guru, don't pester him. Don't pester the teacher. If they say, okay, well, I just need, you know, to a little time to cool out. Done deal. Everything is a done deal like that. No fooling around. No stupid sophomore games or anything like that. Automatically. You don't have to worry like, well, how can I do it? No, you just say, hey, this is where I want. This is it. This is what I want. This is the opportunity. Okay. I'm with it. I'm with the celebration. I'm with the big boost. I'm just with it. And whatever reprimands or any guidelines, whatever is given, fine. Thank you. Whatever corrections, thank you. If someone says, no, that this is mistaken, then just drop it, or just drop this line of what you're saying, or don't say anything, or I don't have an answer. Okay, good, that's fine. A lot of people ask anonymous questions. You say, and no answer occurs to me. There's no response is occurring to me at this moment to respond to that. And people say, okay, that's fine. No problem at all. And then later they might ask another question, and she'd answer it. She says, this is what occurs to me as a response to this. But if there's no response, fine. Everything was fine. Everybody was cool. Very cool with the situation. And the teacher said, I need to go here now. I need to leave. That's it. And everyone say, fine. No problem. And it's just, the people are very accommodating in 5D situations. Very accommodating. Very poised. Very accommodating. Not acting out stuff. Just automatically, because your realization is this is it. This is your opportunity to go gravitate to 5D, what you've been waiting for, and just say okay. And you know, and the teacher knows how to help that. Okay, let we're here to be reassured. That's it. And if there's some way that if we're pursuing a line of questioning that is not helpful, the teacher say that's not helpful. Let's just drop that line and say okay, great. No problem. It's like that. So, and again, in high 3D, people just live and let live. They're not interested in your life. As long as you don't bug them, they don't bug you. Whereas 4D, they're super interested in your life and controlling your life. And okay, tell me about your trauma. Tell me about your life. Tell me about your inner psyche. Tell me about this. Okay, let's do your astrological chart. Let's do your energy chart. Let's do all this stuff. Okay, tell me. Share this, share that. You need to share. Now you go to 5D, you don't need to say anything about your life. You don't need to share anything about your life. It's not totally unnecessary. You don't need to confess to anything. You don't need to confess to your mistakes. All those things are a given that you thought it was necessary. You're working on a contingency plan, survival. It's all a given. It's all a given. You can just be quiet. Teacher knows all of this already. Not particulars. Teacher's completely uninterested in the particulars because it's all unnecessary. It's not, you don't need to integrate anything. You're going to 5D, there's no threat to your survival there. You don't need to have some integral personality to survive. Survival is automatic. It doesn't depend on whatever you did in 4D or 3D. It's not dependent. It's not a step up from 4D or 3D. It is a realm unto itself, 5D. It's entirely, there's no threats there to your survival at all. Never has been. Never has been. So, all of your misadventures, it's a given. Of course, everything in existence has been a misadventure. You don't have to explain yourself. You don't have to explain why you're here, why you're there. You know, 5D situation, you don't have to explain why you're there. It's already a given. It's a given, of course. You want freedom. You want to realize you've never been here. You've never been, and it's totally unnecessary. You want the certitude. You want to be reassured. That's all. You simply want to be reassured about certitude. That's it. You don't need anything else. All the rigmarole that you've been going through in all your misadventures, you forgive yourself for all of it. Is it forgiven? Is it given that you forgive yourself? That's it. That's the sum total. You forgive yourself. It was all unnecessary. Period. It's over. That's it. No need to dig into your memories. Don't need to dig into your traumas. Dig into your past, your childhood. That's all nonsense. At 5D, you don't need to do any of that. Totally irrelevant. All you need is reassurance that reality will never change. That's all you need. And that flattens everything. It deflates everything else. Everything else is deflated. And you just enjoy the reassurance. Just enjoy the reassurance that's there. That's it. And it gets into you like a sponge. You just soak it up. Just soak it up. You don't need to be figuring anything out or asking questions. The teacher already knows exactly what needs to be said. It's very simple. And as you hear in these videos, I already know what to say. I can say it, but that's just mid-level. But high-level is there's the presence of reassurance is there, and you just soak it up. Just soak it up. If something needs to be said, of course they can say something. This is all existence is nothing but a contingency plan. We've just been working on contingency plans. Unnecessary. What more needs to be said? That reality will never change, and we're certain of that. What more needs to be said? That we can exchange these hypothetical scenarios, that there's 5D realm, death-free paradise realm, where nothing's ever been threatened, and you can dwell in that realm still as if you were had a body associated with what you are. There's no problem. And you can set that down eventually too. Very simple. It's very, very simple. What needs to be said is very simple. You don't need to go into all this esoteric mumbo-jumbo and none of it. It's all totally unnecessary. And when you can accept that, you can handle a high 5D situation. High 5D, super reassure. You can handle it. Easy. Because all they're doing is super reassurance, and that's all you need. You don't need any explanations. Whatever explanations they're given, they can easily simply give, or they have some mid-level or high mid-level or low high-level teacher like myself there to explain if any explanations are needed. I can bum 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 bum, so like that, okay, no problem. But they might not need to say anything, but they can, sure they can. It's very simple. You don't have to ask tricky questions either. It's not necessary, because truth is true. It's always true. All we need to know, the truth will always be true. That's all we need to know, period. That's it. But how do we know that? We need to be reassured with the certitude, and it has to be a deep, deep, deep thing that we feel, yes, this is true, and we can see it as true. Because using words intellectually, it's all very fragile, isn't it? It's a house of cards. So we conceptually, we cannot rest on mere conceptuality that it's true, because words are subject to interpretation. We feel, oh, it could collapse. So that we have to realize that we can experience it's true. It's true. We can see it as true. We can know that it's true. We have to be reassured at that level, the level of knowing, seeing and experiencing. So you have to have one that is seeing it, that is knowing it, and it's experiencing the truth. That's the high-level reassure. And the super high-level reassures have that tremendous certitude that just is incredible. You had pilgrims going to India who go to the various teachers, and they got a lot from them, a lot of reassurance. And then some of them went and saw Ananda Mayamma, and when they saw her, they like first time they saw her, they just like dropped to the ground and sit there, and just say, "Holy smokes!" And they feel their whole identity suddenly expanding, some massive field of reassurance of this perfect certitude, and it just like as it extended for miles and miles, and it just like they had these incredible experiences of certitude. It just said this is just like totally unbelievable. They just couldn't believe that such a thing is possible, because the field of reassurance was so powerful. It just extended for miles and miles and miles, where literally the area around where she was felt as super peaceful, and some kind of incredible serenity in miles around. And the people had that experience, and they said, "Holy cow, what is this?" And they said, "I don't think I can handle much more of this." Then they go back to other teachers, because it's a little too intense. So you need various levels of teachers here. It's helpful, because that super high level thing is not many can hang out with that. Not many. And maybe little doses, and they get more used to it, and you can hang out with it more and more and more. But you don't need to say anything. When you're in that situation, you're just like, You're buzzed, you know, spiritually buzzed by some kind of deep certitude. And you say, "Where did that certitude come from? How did I do that? That's amazing. This is beyond conceptuality. No way could conceptuality convey this type of certitude. This is something real is here. Something real certitude is here. I'm in the presence of true certitude in a profound way." And then they get this tremendous spiritual buzz from that. And then how they take it from there on differs in each case. If they have the rich conceptual clarity of context, they have rich contextual clarity, like I've tried to develop, then they can probably set it in the right setting, put that precious stone in the right setting, the precious stone of, that's the pearl of great price Jesus spoke about, set it in the right setting, and then they themselves become also great reassures at some point. Rapid, their progress very rapid towards greater and greater reassurance. Whereas they don't have the contextual clarity, they may go off into 4D or kind of try to integrate it with the world, which gets into 4D, which gets into problems, and they kind of look back on their lives in retrospect and say, "Oh, I had that great experience, but you know, what happened with my life? How come I didn't quite maximize it," or something, which happens. It happens all the time. And yet they have been in ways gravitating towards, and they can look at their life in retrospect and say, "Wow, I didn't make it. I didn't get to where I really wanted to get to." And that honesty in itself is a realization in itself. And when they say, "Wow, I'm not going to hang out in 4D anymore, because I realize that's not it." So failure can be turned into a positive if we're honest about it, and honest that it was a failure. When we admit our failures, we can turn that into positives and say, like, "I admit my failures of wasting all this time trying to find a way to help those in 4D, thinking that they were intellectual enough to understand what I was saying. They had conceptual clarity, enough conceptuality to handle these concepts, but they really didn't understand what I was saying. Yeah, they can conceptually hang with me, but they don't understand what I'm saying. The meaning is lost. They just say, 'Well, you're very smart. You're very smart because you can speak so, use words so well,' but they don't understand what I'm saying. So what's the use? Complete waste of time." There are those who might not say, "Well, I can't really understand what you're saying because I don't understand the words, but I can understand something about it. You're conveying some sort of certitude to me. I can feel it." Those are better off. So those are far better. They're getting something out of the situation. Whereas the intellectuals, most of them don't get anything. They just say, "Oh, yeah, I understand what you're saying." Meaning, "I understand the words that you're using." But they don't understand the meaning the words are conveying, are pointing to. So they're not understanding. That's the problem of intellectuals. Problem of 4D. Where some people, maybe even 3D, might say, "Well, you're talking over my head, but I feel like I'm sort of getting a sense, a feeling of what you're pointing to, and I've got a feeling that I can accept that, you know." So that's they're getting it. Whereas the intellectuals, they jump the gun and say, "Yeah, I understand what you're saying," and that's it. I got it. I aced that test. I think like you're giving them a test. They feel like I'm giving some sort of test. They have to ace. And they say, "Oh yeah, I got it. Okay, I got an A, right?" They say, "I got an A, didn't I?" And I say, "No, no, you did not get an A. You got an F." But there's no test anyway, so you just got an incomplete is what you got. And it needs to be completed. The class is an incomplete. That's all it is. It's not an A, it's not an F, it's an incomplete. And if they realize it is incomplete, then actually they learn something from it. They said, "I didn't get it." And then they say, "Well, why didn't I get it?" I said, "Was it because of the words? Or was it because I didn't understand the words? Or I didn't understand what the words were referring to? Which is it?" And then they say, "Maybe it was I didn't understand what the words are referring to." And so they say, "Oh, okay, I'm not as smart as I thought I was. Why am I not as smart as I thought I was? Oh, maybe my education miseducated me. Maybe it didn't focus on what needed to be focused on." They say, "Wow, so my education was a failure." "Yeah, okay, well, how do I need to correct that failure?" "Okay, well, what do I need to focus on?" "Oh, maybe I need to focus on what's being said here. Maybe I need to look at it in a different way. What is being focused on here?" You see, then the intelligence is working in the right direction in that way, by doing it that way. That's being humble, by being honest, and admitting that one doesn't, was incomplete and needs to look at it in a different way, and then gradually they'll realize they may not be able to do it right away, and they need to keep their arrogance in check and be humble, etc. Then they start gravitating towards 5D, just like that. It's as simple as being honest for 1 second. Just that's it. Just say, "Wait, I didn't understand. I didn't get it." Good. That's a step in the right direction. Say, I didn't really get that at all. But I feel there's something there to get. Now see, if you know, being intellectually dishonest is to say, I didn't get it, and then to take the next step and say, "I didn't get it because there was nothing there to get." That's being dishonest. Because there is something here to get. If you say, "I didn't get it, but I feel like there really is something here to get, and the problem is me. I'm not familiar with what's being said, and I'm not getting it. And I want to get it, so let me just be okay with not getting it for right now. Let me just forgive myself for not getting it." That's the first step, just being okay with that. And then just abiding in that forgiveness of I'm not getting it, and that's okay. That's powerful. I'm not getting it, and that's okay. I forgive myself for not, I know there's something there to get. I'm not getting it, that's okay. I forgive myself. I must have been not paying attention for a long time. I must have been trying to do something that was confusing me for a long time, and that's okay. I forgive myself for that, because I've never really here, and this is all not even necessary at all, but I thought it might be necessary, and that I forgive myself for that too. That's okay. Then that starts opening up doors to listening better. And when you start listening better, you start saying, "Hey, I didn't hear that the first time. Were you saying that before? You sure?" I say, "Yeah." And they say, "Wow, I didn't hear that at all before. I really didn't hear that." Because they were not listening. They were hearing what they thought thought should be said instead of what's being said. That's the problem with the mind. The intellect says it thinks it knows what should be said. So it says, "Well, you must be saying what I believe you should be saying. Because if you're a teacher, you must be saying what I expect you to say. Otherwise, you're not teaching me at all." So they don't really hear what's being said. And they're interpreting it as you must have been saying something else altogether. Where you say yes, they think they hear no. Where you say no, they hear yes. And then when they're willing to really listen, they say, "Oh my gosh, you were saying yes all along." They say, "Yeah, all along I was saying yes." And they say, "Wow, I really wasn't listening well, right?" And they say, "No, that's right." And they say, "Well, I forgive myself for not listening well. That's because I've been very uncertain, very ambivalent. I spent a lot of time trying to celebrate my ambivalence, but now I don't really feel that's it." You see how the path can very easily go very easily. Take humility and honesty. Those two. Those two. When you're humble and when you're honest and forgiving. Those three, let's say. Those three. Those are the keys. Being very humble. Did you say, I don't know it all? And there's something I need to know. Being very honest and saying, you know, I don't get it. And I'm not, I'm having trouble with this. Honest, humble, honest. And third, forgiving. Those three. Humble, honest, and forgiving yourself. Then you're literally on the path that then opens the door to listening. Listening's the fourth. And then hearing's the fifth. Those are like five steps, as it were. Even though if you're super smart, if you're with a 5D teacher, 5D teacher is more clued in than you are. Really. They're more clued in because they realize all this other stuff is not necessary. So they're exclusively focused on what is necessary, and the other stuff is just, they're not even interested in it. So they're more clear. They're able to maintain the emphasis better. It's not that you can't see it. You can. But you're not able to maintain the emphasis like they are. So you just have to be humble about that, and honest, and forgiving, and listening and hearing. You have to be in that mode. But there are those who can understand, but they can't quite give the exclusive focus and drop the other stuff. They say, yeah, I got that, but I got to get all this other answers too. So the struggle's going on. It can be very intense. Whereas what they need to do is just say, okay, let me forgive myself. Let me be humble. Let me listen. And let me shift the emphasis here. Maybe I don't need to be answering all this other stuff. And it's a struggle for them. And they have to accept that it's a struggle. And say, it's okay. It's a struggle. But let me understand here, I don't need to act out the struggle. Struggle, I've got internal struggle, I've got some anxiety, it's a difficult. So let me just accept that as right now it's a struggle. That's okay. Because that's a phase. That is a phase where you want to please everything. You want to get the answers for everything. You say, okay, I can get this, but what about this? And the teacher says, 5D teacher says, you don't need that. Because where you're going, there's no threats to survival. So you don't need all that other stuff of 4D. You don't need any answers. And then you gotta say, oh, wow, that's amazing. I don't know if I can handle that or not. And then you just have to abide, see if you can abide with that. And if you can't, you just say, okay, I'm having trouble with that. And say, that's okay, I'm having a little trouble with that. And I need to just relax and cool down. So it's doable. It's doable, because very intense people will think they need to get all the answers, and then they're in a situation where they have to decide which way they're going to go. Is it 4D or 5D? And if they want 5D, they have to realize they don't need all the answers, because they need to know there's only one answer. The other stuff, there is no answer to. It's a search, a pursuit for answers that will never be satisfied. 4D won't find the answers. 3D won't find the answers. There is no answer as to how to survive annihilation. There's no answer. If annihilation were real, there would be no survival of it. And if it's unreal, what are we doing trying to find a way to survive it? It's crazy, right? If it's unreal, we don't need to find a way to contingency plan. If it's real, we couldn't survive it. And if it's unreal, we don't need any contingency plan. So we don't need any answers. We only need to know that there's an intermediate step back to reality. And we only need to be reassured that reality, we don't need the contingency plan. That's all we really need. And that intellectually you can hear it. And then you can gradually get used to it and accept that. So don't sell yourself short. If you struggle with this, don't sell yourself short. If you can feel a sense of humor and a sense it's okay, and acceptance of acceptance and some humility and all that, if you can feel all this and a forgiveness, forgiving yourself, then probably you can get with 5D teaching. You can probably get with it. You can probably hang out with it. Say, hey, this isn't too bad. It's not so tough. And it's doable. Whereas if you feel really belligerent and really upset and angry and unforgiving and harsh on yourself, etc., then it's more problematic. But I get that way sometimes. I get, like on the 21st, I got really mad myself. Really mad. It was terrible. That's terrible. Hopefully that's the last time I'd ever do that. It's awful. I was really angry at myself for being so slow, for taking so long on this path. I was so furious. It's like, why am I such an incredible, so slow? I'm wasting everybody's time. I didn't make it on time. I could help people. I'm not able to help them. I'm just, for some reason, I'm just super, super reluctant and slow. And why? I don't know why. So I got really mad. Then I had to fight against that and finally cool out somehow. And just say, wow, let me just cool out. I gotta cool out. So it was really difficult. It was bad. But now I'm back, you know, better than ever, being very cooled out and forgiving and okay about the whole thing. But yeah, it gets that way sometimes. But if you can most of the time not be that way, then that's okay. But sometimes you're going to get harsh on yourself. Why am I so slow? This is terrible. I'm an idiot. Like, how can I be such an idiot? Because intellectually you got it, but the certitude is not there. And so that holds you back and makes you want to search for answers instead of go to a place where there's no threats at all. You want to be in a place where there are threats and find ways to survive them. You want to integrate it all, and you want to find a way to relate to 4D and help those, and you want to try and be compassionate when situations where maybe people simply don't want to listen to what you have to say. So all of that gets in the way. It's not easy. So I guess I haven't been that slow. I've gone as fast as I could. It seems slow to me, but the issues involved are quite difficult to resolve, really. So I'm still trying to resolve them. And hopefully I'll be hanging out in some 5D situation soon. Very soon. And maybe again high 3D. And again, that will put off the 4D people very much so. They won't like that at all, which is okay with me, actually. Very much okay. It takes a real dedicated 5D person to hang out in high 3D, which would be like some super exclusive, gated country club, beautiful mansion house type of situation where everything seems so lush and beautiful, manicured golf course, etc. 40 people hate that. They say, oh, you're not spiritual. What are you talking about? You're some service to self, elitist, blah, blah, blah. You know, how can you? You're hanging out with those terrible people and they won't go there. They won't go. Are you kidding? Are you kidding? They will not go. Whereas those who are really oriented to 5D say, hey, wait a minute. This place has got like an echo of 5D to it as far as the beauty of it, and say, yeah, this is really cool. And I don't care the people there are like, who am I to judge? I don't care. As long as I'm able to hang out with 5D teacher situation, fine. That's fine. I don't even want to hang out with 4D anyway. So no bother me. I don't have any. For me, it doesn't bother me going to these like elitist places at all. It doesn't bother me because I'm looking at the beauty of the place, and it gives like a. It gives an echo of the death-free paradise realms. It does. It's an attempt, a 3D attempt to establish paradise in 3D. But the attempt to establish paradise in 3D is not as control freakish as it is in 4D. And so it's really probably easier to have a 5D situation within the 3D paradise type of situation, really. So it automatically differentiates for people, and if 5D people, no problem, whatever. If this is where the teachers are, this is where it's happening, fine. Where and the 4D people say, be right there. The 4D people say, ah, no way, we're not gonna hang out there. Are you kidding? Ah, terrible. All right, that's it. The people are coming around, so I gotta end this right now. Okay, very great. Merry Christmas. Hope to see you soon in some great 5D situation.